This video will introduce Lesson 5 in ROS. Along the way, we've mentioned the term doggish. Now we will introduce it more formally. There are two types of doggish. There is the doggish lene, and there is the doggish forte. In both cases, the doggish is a dot that's written in the consonant. So here you have a bet with a doggish, and a gimel with a doggish, and a dalet. In the case of the begad kafat letters, the bet, the gimel, the dalet, the kaf, the pei, and the tav, and a way to remember that is begad kafat. With the begad kafat letters, what the doggish will do is change the pronunciation. So with the doggish, they are said to be pronounced as a stop. So this would be ba and ga and da and ka and pa and ta. But without the doggish, as we learn when we introduce the alphabet, they will be pronounced differently as a spirant. So this would not be ba, but va, like a V. And even though in modern Israeli there's no distinction, originally it would be a ga versus a ka. And in modern Israeli there's no distinction, but originally it was a da and a da, with a more like a dh. And then there, the kaf would be a ka and a ka, a little more aspiration, ka and ka. And then the pe would be a pa, but without the doggish, it would be a fa, like an F or a PH. And then, again, in modern Israeli, there's no distinction, but the tav was either a ta or a tha. So the distinction in terms of what it did for the reader was it told you how to pronounce the begad kafat letter. Now, the rules of when you're going to have a doggish are as follows. If the word begins with a begad kafat letter, and there's either nothing in front of it or a major punctuation in front of it, then it will be pronounced as a stop. So here you have bayit, the word house. There is no word in front of it. It's just a new beginning. And it will always have a doggish. It will always have a doggish lene in that position. Or if it follows a closed syllable. Here you have mid-bar. Well, mid is a syllable. And then bar begins a new syllable. Well, a begad kafat letter that follows a closed syllable will have the doggish. Conversely, the letter, a begad kafat letter is written without the doggish, without the dot, when it follows a vowel sound, including a vocal shava. So in this case, you have kokavim, you have a open syllable, a kaf and a holam vav, so a ko sound. And since the kaf is preceded by a vowel, it will lack the doggish. It too is a open syllable, ka, and therefore the bet, another begad kafat letter, will lack the doggish because it's preceded by a vowel. Now the same will apply if a begad kafat letter is preceded by a word that ends in a vowel. So here you have vayahi, that ends with a hirik yod vowel, an E sound. And thus, the ken, thus, This is from Genesis 1, Vayehi Chen, and it was so, after God created certain, said to create certain things. But anyway, it ends with a vowel, and therefore the kaf will lack the dog ash. So the dog ash line is written in the Bagad Kafat letters, the bet, the gimel, the dalet, the kaf, the pe, and the chet, to indicate that they are stops when no vowel immediately precedes the letter. The other type of dog ash is the dog ash forte. Dog ash fortes are basically put in a consonant to indicate that the consonant is to be doubled. That is, it indicates that there are two of those consonants. So the example here is the word for woman, isha. Here you have a dog ash in the sheen. And the purpose of that dog ash is to indicate that there are two sheens there. So that's not isha, that is ish sha with two sh sounds. So here you have the aleph, then the ish, a sheen, then a sheen, and then the kamatse ending indicated by the A with a hat on the top of it. And so that affects the pronunciation too. It indicates that there are two consonants there. Originally, before the Masoretes put the vowels in, you just had to know the language well enough to know that certain letters had to be doubled in certain contexts. But in this case, it does it by indicating it with a dog ash. Now, this can even happen with Bagad Kafat letters. So here you have the word Shaddai, the Almighty. And here you have a patah and then a dalet with a dog ash in it. Now, if this were a open syllable, you would not have the dog ash. It has to be a closed syllable. And besides, patah is a short vowel, and an unaccented syllable, closed syllable, has to have a short vowel. So since it's unaccented and closed, it has to be a short vowel, so it's a patah. But then that also shows a doubling, which gives the next vowel something to hang on, the die, shad, die, two D's in that context. Now, when that happens, the dalet will be pronounced as a stop. So the dog ash is really doing double duty. It's telling us that this is a, it is to be pronounced as a stop, as a duh, rather than as a spirant, duh. But it also tells you that it's doubled in this particular case. The clear example is isha, because sheens do not have spirant and stop options. The only thing that the dog ash will do with a letter like sheen is to double it. Here is yet another example. Mikol, which means from every or from each, depending on what follows. But there you have a mem with a hirik. The kaf is being doubled, but that also makes it pronounced as a stop. And so it's Mikol, two K's. Yet another example is Kid Deshu, where you have a hirik, and then you have a dalet with a dog ash in it, followed by a shava. Now, if this were an open syllable, ki, then the dalet could not have a dog ash. And if it lacked the dog ash, you'd actually pronounce it kid shu. But because it has the dog ash, it's actually pronounced kid de shu with a vocal shava rather than a silent shava. And again, an unaccented closed syllable needs to have a short vowel, and so this is an unaccented closed syllable with a short vowel, but then the dog ash, the shava, hangs on the second dalet. Now, in addition, we need to mention that there are certain letters that will not accept dagesh. The four gutturals, aleph, he, het, and ayin, along with the often connected with gutturals resh, will not accept dagesh. They are weak letters. Try to put a dot at them, they will spit it right out. They will not accept dagesh. And of course, the Bagad Kapat letters, as we've said, will accept dagesh, but it also affects their pronunciation. Sometimes it's dagesh line, which is just to indicate that it's a stop. Sometimes it'll be both dagesh line and dagesh forte to indicate it's both a stop and a doubling. All the other letters will accept dagesh, but it only indicates doubling. It's a dagesh forte. Now, one other thing about dagesh before we leave it, and this one is less important than what we've said so far, but it's in the book, so I'll go over it. An initial consonant is sometimes written with a dagesh forte for the sake of euphony, the strengthening or doubling, in that case, is not essential. One place where this can happen is when the two words are closely connected in pronunciation. So, for example, when you have two words connected with a makef, well, that will sometimes cause the a dagesh to appear in the following word. Or in the case of one accent is governing two words, even where you don't have a makef. So here you have the example, ki asita zot, which should actually pronounce ki asita zot, where you're actually kind of closing the syllable, and therefore you put a dagesh in there. And so where you have closely connected it, in this case, the zot does not have its own accent, but the accent is on the previous word, well, it's accepting a dagesh in that condition. Well, as we said, this is not terribly essential, but you may have a question, you know, why is there a dagesh in this word? And this is the answer. In most cases, it will not keep you from rightly translating and interpreting a word, whether or not it has the dagesh or does not. And then the last thing we'll say in this segment has to do with the mafik. Now, this has to do with the letter he. The letter he can have two functions. It can either function as a consonant, ha, where you actually aspirate and make a sound, ha, ha. Or it can be a vowel letter, in which case it makes no sound. So here you have an example of two forms, malka and malka. Malka, there the hay is silent. You just have an sound at the end, transliterated with an A with a hat on it. And that would mean queen. But it turns out that malka, with a little bit of aspiration, has a different meaning, and it would be transliterated differently too. Malka, with a long A and an H there, and that would mean her king. And the Masoretes have distinguished this by putting a little dot, not a dog H, but it's called a mapik, in the consonant of the, in the hay, if it is pronounced as a consonant rather than a vowel letter. And so if you see a dot in a final hay, a hay at the end of the word, well then that tells you that must be a consonantal value hay, and it will actually have a huh sound and not just be a vowel letter. And in this particular case, it makes a complete difference in meaning between Malka, queen, and Malka, her king. Well, we'll go on and finish the lesson in the next video.